Lauren Spearer. Lauren was a University of Indiana student who was last seen walking downtown in Bloomington, Indiana, during the early morning hours of June 3, 2011. The Scarsdale, New York native was in Bloomington to study fashion merchandising and was still dating her high school boyfriend of 3 years. Despite tips and many hours, no one knows what happened to Lauren. She met her boyfriend Jesse Wolf and her friend Jay Rosenbaum earlier at Camp Tawanda, a summer camp in the mountain town of Honesdale, Pennsylvania. On that last night, June 2, 2011, Lauren was out drinking with several friends. Her boyfriend Jesse was at home that night, but they had texted back and forth before he went to bed. Witnesses said that Lauren was pretty drunk. She was also doing drugs that night. It appears those drugs were likely to be crushed up Klonopin, which was snorted, as well as cocaine. It's also been reported that the police found a small amount of cocaine in her room. She also had a heart problem that could have been negatively affected by drug use. There's no way to know for sure that they were doing drugs, or if so, what it was. But if it was Klonopin that was being crushed up, that can be very dangerous if you drink at the same time. It can slow your breathing down, and your body can actually forget to breathe. Klonopin is a benzodiazepine, which is meant to avoid seizures. If you crush it up, it will cause a euphoric high, although that is a very short-lived feeling. The Bloomington Police Department were able to pull together a comprehensive timeline of the events that night through video surveillance and witness statements. She watched the NBA playoffs that night with friends, leaving home at 12:30 a.m. with a friend named David Rohn. They went to Jane Rosenbaum's apartment, where they met up with Corey Rossman. Rossman was Rosenbaum's neighbor, as well as Rossman's roommate, a man named Michael Beth. She spent the next 4 hours moving among different parties and bars with different combinations of friends: Rosenbaum, Rohn, Beth, and Rossman. At 1:46 a.m., she was seen entering Kilroy Sports Bar. At 2:27 a.m., she exited the bar with Rossman, leaving both her cell phone and her shoes inside. They went out to a covered patio, and she was eventually seen walking home to her apartment, still without her shoes or her phone. 3 minutes later, she is captured at the apartments. A passerby noted she was extremely inebriated, so much so that he stopped to ask if she was okay. When they got to the fifth floor of the building where Lauren's apartment is, they ran into 4 male students in the hallway. Rossman mouthed off to one of those men, and that man countered by punching him. It was said later that the man was upset at how Rossman was treating Lauren. Rossman would conveniently then claim that he can't remember what happens from this moment on. Lauren and Rossman were captured again, leaving her apartment at 2:48 a.m., and they entered an alleyway that runs between College Avenue and Morton Street. The police refused to release any of this footage. However, the security cameras on different buildings captured them exiting the alley at 2:51 a.m., walking toward an empty lot. Her keys and her purse were found alone along this route throughout the alley. Surveillance cameras in the alley show her stumbling, and at some point Rossman tosses her over his shoulder in a fireman's carry. It appears that it was around this time that Lauren fell twice, causing obvious damage to her head in 2 different spots. It appears this is why Rossman chose to pick her up and carry her. Rossman was also extremely intoxicated, and he was stumbling around. Rossman vomited on the carpet on the way up the stairs to the apartment. Lauren and Rossman later arrive at Rossman's apartment shortly afterward. Michael Beth was at the apartment already. Beth told police that he escorted Rossman to bed because of his drunken condition. He then tried to persuade Lauren to sleep over for her own safety. He says she refused to do so, insisting on going home. Because Lauren refused to stay, Beth went ahead and called Rosenbaum 3 minutes later at 3:30 a.m. Beth said that he decided to call Rosenbaum to ask him to take care of Lauren because she insisted on leaving and wasn't in a condition to do so. Lauren was being unruly and only wanted to keep drinking, insisting that he leave to go drink with her back at her apartment. She then proceeded to leave Beth's home, going to Rosenbaum's apartment. By then, Lauren had a large bruise under her eye that was becoming worse. It was one of the wounds she received earlier in her fall. Two calls were placed to Rosenbaum's phone just before Lauren left. One was to David Rohn, and the other was to someone not identified. Neither party picked up the phone, and no messages were left. Rosenbaum told the police that Lauren left his apartment alone about 4:30 that morning, which is the last sighting of her. She was still barefoot, and she was seen wearing black leggings and a white shirt at the intersection of 11th Street and College Avenue. She was heading in the direction of her apartment, which by now was 2.5 blocks away. Several hours later, Jesse Wolf, her boyfriend, sent Lauren a text. He received a reply not from her, but by an employee at the bar. The police conducted a 9-day search of the area, including a local landfill. Hundreds of volunteers joined the parents and the authorities in the massive search. Lauren's family focused in on her boyfriend, as well as Rossman, Beth, and Rosenbaum, the last three people known to have seen her. They also zoned in on Jesse's account of whether he was sleeping or not when she disappeared. However, from what I can see, there is zero indication that Jesse Wolf had anything to do that night other than texting his girlfriend. There are always so many what-if scenarios in these tragedies, and I think perhaps that's what may have happened there. Either way, her family included him in a demand for lie detector tests. From what I can tell, the only man who agreed to take one was, in fact, Wolf. However, his family chose to pay a highly respected private firm instead of asking someone with less experience at the police department to do so. It appears it was this move that upset her parents. However, Jesse's family released the full findings of the lie detector test, and Jesse passed it. Jesse left town after a while, and his parents said he was devastated at what happened. Lauren's family claims he wasn't as helpful as he could have been. On that account, Alan Wolf, Jesse's father, insists his son fully cooperated, openly discussing the case with the parents, the police, and their private investigator, saying the Spears are coming out now telling lies. They also said that if Jesse was guilty of anything, it was guilty of taking care of Lauren too much, who had some serious drug issues. She would abuse to the point where she would black out, and Jesse always threatens to call and tell her parents. She said, "If you do, I'll break up with you." He was afraid to lose her. It came out then that there was a history of drug abuse on the part of Lauren. Lauren and Jesse originally met at a youth camp, and Lauren was asked to leave due to her drug abuse. The police did indicate that at age 20, Lauren was arrested for public intoxication. Her family spoke out of their frustration. Of the boys Lauren was with that night, all of them hired lawyers right away except for Jesse Wolf, and only Jesse Wolf helped in the searches. The only real possible lead in what happened was a white truck that was seen in the area. It was spotted around the same time that all of this went down, and they have been unable to locate the truck. Lauren's family was openly critical with the police. They were very tight-lipped with information, not just with the public, but with them also. It was a further point of contention that they wouldn't release any images of her on surveillance video other than the few that were released. And there were a number of those that were hidden from both family and public, something the family said baffled them, because that is usually the first thing the police release. There was a student named Hannah Wilson who lived in the area in 2015 when she was murdered. Her murderer, Daniel Messel, has been brought up as a suspect. Hannah Wilson was beat to death and uncaringly discarded in a field. Messel has been linked to 3 other cases of violence against women, one of which was his own grandmother. The police have chosen not to comment. There is no indication if there is any evidence at all that link him to the disappearance of Lauren. The final lead to emerge was that of Corey Hammersley. I wish I could include the image of him being arrested, but if I do so, I would end up being reported. You can Google it. It's fuzzy and you can't really see anything, but he stepped out of his apartment wearing nothing but evil intentions and a hat. He brandished a gun and he shot up a house, eventually attacking the police when they arrived. Hammersley was very active in the drug scene at the time. There was no indication he personally knew Lauren, but another inmate reported that there was something he said that indicated he knows what happened. He was playing cards with another inmate who reported that Lauren's photo came up on the TV. It was at this time that Hammersley stated, "Man, I knew the guys that did that." He went on to say that she was drinking and doing ecstasy with the guys that he knew and she OD'd, following up with them disposing of her in the Ohio River. This could be true. Her parents were open that she had a heart condition, that could be affected by drug use. However, she was seen walking away alone on that video. She didn't disappear at the house, and none of the males were caught on camera following her at any point. Hammersley was interviewed by the authorities to find out what he actually knew, but he refused to help at all, saying, "I do not want to be associated with this at all." Her case remains open and unsolved. Lauren's family is very active to this day in trying to find answers and begging for the truth so that they can start to heal. It appears there was never any legal ramifications for the last three men seen with Lauren that night. Her body has never been found. Jesse remained the only one of the group that complied with the investigation. His family reported that he was devastated, believing that he lost the love of his life and was in therapy and out of the spotlight. Hopefully he's begun to heal and has been able to move on. Sadly, Lauren was just 20 when she disappeared. She would be 30 now if still alive. The Facebook account they used to announce family information on this case is listed in a link below in the description. If you have any information at all about her death, whether it be about the vehicle or anything else involved, please call the number on your screen. That's it for today. Thank you for watching and listening. If you haven't yet, please hit the subscribe button. Take care of yourselves and each other.